All right. So I'm going to start with a story that I have to share with all of you. When I was about 10 years old, I received a gift from one of my uncles. This was a novel. And it was a bit of a milestone for me at the time because this was the first grown-up gift that I had received. I was extremely excited about the gift. And the book itself, I remember, was small. And I remember flipping through the pages and trying to imagine what part of the story those black and white images interspersed in the book were telling. Once I started reading the book, my excitement did not dim even a little bit. I loved everything about it. I loved the story. I loved the characters with their own unique stories, their mannerisms. So much so that I could imagine what they'd look like in person. Looking back, there are two things that stand out to me about this experience. One, the whole process of imagination that reading unleashed for me. Till date, I love reading books, and I'm at my best when it involves doing something which requires me to use my imagination. And two, it opened a whole new world for me, a world of stories, stories other than my own, perspectives other than my own. And that quality, till date, helps me to understand where other people are coming from, their unique points of view. And that has helped me not just personally, but even professionally. Like most things of great value, perspective building, understanding other points of view takes time, it takes patience, and if you're lucky, you also get to collect some interesting stories on the way. Growing up in a place not too far from here, a small town in Punjab, I remember looking forward to my days off of school. You know, in India, you can never be far away from a festival or a celebration. And I remember looking forward to it because I'd have my own gang of friends wanting to dance to the drum beats together. No clue of what's happening around, not worrying about parents shouting, just enjoying the moment. And as I grew older, I remember watching all of these events unfold from the balcony of my house. And those two perspectives were extremely different, a very, very different experience. One, being in the epicenter of all the chaos, of just being in the rhythm, not worrying about what went by just before, what's going to happen ahead, just being in the moment. And second, watching all of these events unfold from the balcony of the house. Being a little away, still planning a day of nothing doing with my friends, but from a very different point of view. That particular analogy, to this date, has helped me in various scenarios. So being able to switch between the view from, well, let's call it the dance floor, and the balcony has been an interesting understanding of perspectives other than my own. It not only helps me to relate to people, it helps to also understand the perspectives of people who I probably don't get along very well with, because they think very differently from how I do. And it's also made all the difference in actually not just making acquaintances at work and personally, but also building deep, meaningful relationships with them. So in keeping with the theme today, what I wanted to share with you all is three snippets from my personal journey that have made me stay true not just to my purpose, but at the same time have also allowed me to keep adding on to my own perspective and the way I view things, and in the process, enriched my personal journey. One of the first things that I want to talk about is the perspective building that starts with your own self. Like I say, with most things, it starts at home. While there are a lot of concepts and models that talk about how one really goes about making that thought process, that personal journey, to understand what drives one, the one concept I personally relate to quite a bit is the Japanese concept of ikigai. While ikigai has been around for quite a while, and there are other concepts which talk in very similar terms, the one reason I personally find ikigai very relevant today is because it's essentially a sweet spot of intersection between not just what drives you, but also what makes larger value and therefore makes what you do more meaningful for the community and the world around you. And at the same time is rooted in practicalities like, can you make a livelihood out of what you're passionate about? So essentially, ikigai is four things coming together. One, what are you passionate about? Killer thing. I think Warren Buffet summarized it very well in saying that think about the job you'd be doing if you didn't have to do a job. Imagine doing something without any pressure. And that is a very, very reasonable understanding of what one is passionate about. It can make all the difference in terms of getting up on a Monday morning, not wanting to do anything, and thinking of procrastination, and then waking up on a Friday morning, and doesn't matter what comes your way, you're ready to take it head on. The second important thing that goes into finding one's ikigai is, of course, again about you, which is essentially to say, what are the skills that you think can help you achieve that passion? What is it that you're good at? For example, when I look back, I can think about a couple of things that made me get to where I am today. Think about your personal journey so far, and what is it that made you stand out from your contemporaries at any given point in time? And that's probably close to the skills that you're good at. I do want to call out one thing here. As we grow in our personal journeys, it's needless to say, so does our ikigai, which means at one point in time, if let's say today you find you go on and you have a completely different personal journey from what you've had till now, your ikigai will evolve with you too. The third thing that goes into finding one's ikigai is about generating value which is greater than one's own, which means how can I make a positive impact on the community around me, on the people around me? Is there a way that my skills and passion combined can make a difference to the world around me? And finally, can I make a livelihood out of it? Which is, let's admit, a very, very important part of what we continue to do in our lives. So for me, ikigai is possibly the truest, most authentic representation of what one's purpose is. And like I said, it evolves. Also, it takes time, it takes patience, and at the same time, it's also the truest manifestation of what one can achieve in their lives. The second thing that I want to speak about today is more to do with perspectives and builds with the help of people around. And when I say people around, it's not just about people that you get along well with. It's also about people that you probably don't see eye to eye with. People that you may not relate to right away, because their way of thinking is very different from how you think. One person that continues to influence me even posthumously today is my father. I remember growing up and watching him go to work every day. And even when I look back today, in the 26 short years of knowing him, never once was he late to work. To me as a child, that was a value worth admiring in terms of his punctuality and the ethic that he followed. But today, when I look back, it's a much more deeper representation and a manifestation of a personal value of accountability that he held very close to his heart. And it's something that I've inherited from him, though I have to warn you, most of my friends, if they heard me speak this, they'd probably tell you I'm not always on time. But it is my own personal representation of accountability which helps me continue to go that extra mile even when I feel like giving up. And it's a value that I hold dear. That's the thing about perspectives, you know. One perspective needn't be right at the cost of the other. I'm not sure if you know a person by the name John Atchison. He's a wildlife filmmaker. He was a wildlife filmmaker. And he wrote this book called The Shark and the Albatross. There's a very interesting account in that book which talks about two film crews simultaneously capturing an albatross and a couple of sharks. So the scenario is like this. It unfolds in a remote place in Hawaii, and there is one part of the film crew that's filming an albatross. An albatross is an oceanic white bird, seabird, and it takes long flights before it comes to rest on the surface of the ocean before taking off again. The second film crew is filming underwater, and they're filming a couple of sharks circling around the area where the albatross is expected to land. As the scene unfolds, the albatross comes to sit on the surface of water, just as a shark soars towards the surface and breaks through, causing the albatross to literally run on the surface of water before taking a flight again. Now, what's interesting in the book is the description of the two film crews of this particular event. The one film crew that's looking at the albatross is very empathetic to the plight of the bird. The fact that the bird did not get a chance to even sit its heels down, cool off, before having to take off again for survival. Whereas the second film crew that's filming the sharks is in complete awe of the predatory skills of the apex predator that the shark is. When you think about it, none of the perspectives are wrong. Not one is more truthful than the other. But coming together, both of these perspectives tell you something very unique about the story. It creates a much more completer picture of the entire event unfolding, and therefore the experience that you have of this entire event is much richer. The third and final thing that I want to talk about today is to do with a word that makes a lot of us uncomfortable. It's a word that represents an emotional phenomenon, if allowed, can actually limit one's potential quite a bit and has the power to blur one's perspective quite a bit as well. The word is fear. Let's be straight about something. All of us are afraid of one thing or the other, be it speaking something truthfully, be it being the most honest, truthful version of ourselves, be it the fear of failure, or the more rational fear of the assorted reptilian creatures. All of us are afraid of one thing or the other. But what makes the difference between facing this fear head-on and letting it decide what kind of decisions you make is essentially the relationship you build with fear. It's very easy to let fear tell you that don't raise your hand in class, or don't raise your hand for a particular opportunity at work, because there is a chance you may fail. But at the same time, if you were to treat fear as an ally, more like a friendly forewarning of what could go wrong, and use it as an opportunity to stay prepared, you will see a drastic shift in the kind of relationship you have with fear. It takes, again, time, it takes patience, and it takes a lot of self-reminding to not let fear decide what you will do with the most important decisions in your life. So the next time you're afraid, call fear out to have a chat with you, maybe over a cup of coffee or tea or even a glass of wine, and understand where it's coming from. Is it rooted in reality, or is it just your imagination? Is it rooted in reality, and can you do something about it? More like preparing for the worst case sort of a scenario, and you will see the equation with fear change drastically. So those were the three snippets from my personal journey in terms of perspective building that I wanted to share with you all today. As I sign off, there is a quote by Maya Angelou that I want to share with all of you, which goes something like this. If you spend too much time being normal, you will never know how truly amazing you can be. So grow, explore, and all the best. Thank you.